Shalom, Chavrim. I'm Stephen Benoon. You're watching Israeli News Live. Very, very tense situation in Syria, and that tension is growing and being felt worldwide. In today's broadcast, we are going to look at some of the latest breaking stories that are coming out from Syria, what the U.S. is saying, what other nation members are saying around the world, including that of Europe and that of Russia, and as well examine some of the stories back in time and some of the positions of people, key people, and their opinions on this conflict that may very well surprise you, especially several professors from the United States that have weighed in and spoke to the United Nations about our participation as Americans in the war here in the Middle East, and also why is Israel involved in this? Let's get right to it. One of the stories coming out, of course, today being June the 28th, 2017. This story came out yesterday on RT. Britain would back new U.S. airstrikes on Syrian regime targets. Fallen video, according to the title right here. And it's saying that Britain is absolutely ready to support retaliation by U.S. President Donald Trump against Bashar Assad in Syria, UK Defense Secretary Michael Fallon has said. The U.S. claimed on Monday that Assad was potentially preparing a deadly chemical weapons attack on rebel forces and threatened to hit back with new bombing raids. Now, this is very troubling to see that the U.S. coalition is building a case, justifying a case to be able to strike again at Syria. And we're going to go into this in just a few moments about this alleged chemical attacks that supposedly President Assad has done on his people before and some other issues as well. Also, Maria Zakharova, the foreign minister, spokeswoman for the Russian Foreign Ministry, drew parallels between the current U.S. accusations in Syria to George W. Bush's lies about Iraq. In an article entitled Zakharova, Russia Alarmed at U.S. Threats to Syria. This is being reported on the Duran.com on their website there. But anyway, Ms. Zakharova wrote this: "We know from the past that George Bush regime has already used the falsification of facts on weapons of mass destruction in Iraq against its own people to carry out military aggression against that country. We are seriously concerned over this." Well, I can definitely understand why she's made that statement there. And of course, at the same time, looking at current event news that's going on, we also had this report come out today from the Amman News article here. Al-Masada News.com is reporting a large amount of tanks and, of course, armored personnel carriers. The Turkish government has moved into the northern area near the northern Aleppo, preparing for a massive offense inside the country of Syria. Now, I've stated from the very beginning, I know that Russia has allied somewhat with Turkey, but Russia still needs to be remembering that Turkey is a NATO ally. And, of course, is not in support of President Bashar al-Assad. He has clearly stated when President Trump launched the 59 cruise missiles there after the last alleged chemical weapons attack back in May, that he was cheering President Trump on and said he didn't do enough. I believe that Russia is going to find out that Turkey is going to be there to support NATO when the next major air campaign comes against the Syrian government. And of course, right now too, in Israel's northern border in the Golan, Israel has already closed off the Golan. That was one of the main places that we used to go there and watch the war inside of Syria as it continued on. That has been closed to all tourists. There is no one allowed in the Golan right now. Tanks have been moved in Israel up to the Golan Heights there. They are preparing for a possible, as they have called it, a spillover. They already have seen the spillover of mortars. But I can't help but wonder if Israel is not getting ready to be a part of a major offensive against Damascus to finally bring down President Bashar al-Assad, something we have been reporting on now for weeks already about this. But you know, everything is hinging on this alleged chemical attack. Remember I told you about Aaron Erdem, who is a MP member of the Turkish parliament. He's also a Kurdish man, by the way, who is allied right now with the U.S. fighting in Raqqa, Syria. But as a Kurdish parliament member inside of Turkey, he came out and exposed his government's part in arming ISIS with sarin gas, smuggling it through Turkey, that was later blamed on Bashar al-Assad, whereas that was, and I've shared in this in videos before, when Aaron Erdem, right there to his own parliament, they put the video out where he was clearly identifying that the Turkish government, all the way up to the prime minister, was involved in allowing the ISIS militants that they had the evidence on with the sarin gas to leave the country. All charges were dropped, go into Syria, and then later use that sarin gas attack on the civilians there, only to be blamed on President Bashar al-Assad during Barack Obama's administration, getting America to be able to justify to increase its war against the Syrian government. And I say it's war because it has been the United States that has backed the Free Syrian Army from the very beginning. And of course, there are some claims that the U.S. is also backing others as well, Al-Qaeda, Al-Nusra, and even ISIS. In some cases, that's been reported. But you know, it's been some time since I brought out this right here from 21st Century Wire. Actually, this is on a article here on Before It's News. The person that wrote this, just trying to see which contributor this is. Oh, it is a 21st Century Wire's Before It's News particular address here. Now, the man you see on your screen right now is Henry Lowendorf, and I'm going to play for you just a clip of Henry Lowendorf in just a moment. But Henry Lowendorf was one of many different peace members that went to Syria, and I believe that was in 2015 that they went there. Could be wrong, maybe 2016, I've forgotten now. It's been a while since I looked at this. But it was also Alfred Martyr, Mary Compton. Alfred Martyr, by the way, is the president of the U.S. Peace Council. Mary Compton is a member of the executive board of the U.S. Peace Council. Henry Lowendorf is a member of the executive board of the U.S. Peace Council, head of the Syria delegation that actually went to Syria. We also had Joe Jameson, member of the executive board of the U.S. Peace Council, member of the Syrian delegation. Madeline Hoffman, executive director of the New Jersey Peace Action, member of the Syrian delegation. And Donna Nasser, professor and lawyer, also part of U.S. Peace Council. Not to mention, we had Vanessa Bealey, we had Ava Bartlett, another journalist, well-respected journalist, all of these speaking at the United Nations about their findings inside of Syria. And these Peace Council members, by the way, did meet with both the Syrian the Syrian government under President Bashar al-Assad, as well as they also met with the opposition from the Free Syrian Army that was fighting against this in the war. The troubling thing is that the Peace Council members who are trying, as representatives, by the way, of the United States of America, all these are American citizens that were there, very well respected in their community, came here and they were trying to share with us what their insights were on this war inside of Syria. And I want to play for you just a little bit of what was said, especially by Henry Wallendorf. Very, very serious, very troubling information. Listen to this here.
I think what Alfred said is so true. We are fighting a mass of propaganda that has demonized the Syrian government, demonized its leaders, an effort that precedes every other intervention that the United States has made over the course of many, many decades, in order to convince people that it's okay for quote-unquote humanitarian reasons to overthrow a government and to replace it with whatever. The United States prefers a government that is not independent, that is a willing participant in what the U.S., whatever U.S. policy.
The shock of the reporter's face.
So what we saw in Damascus and what we saw in the two villages we visited outside Damascus belies the propaganda that has overwhelmed us. It's hard. It's hard for even those of us who have been in the peace movement for a long time. It's hard for us to ignore this propaganda. It is so well orchestrated.
Now, of course, Henry Lowendorf is speaking about the U.S. propaganda, whether any of the news media outlets that have been portraying this as a conflict that is so horribly done by President Bashar al-Assad, that he is the evil guy in all of this, and that he needs to be done away with, that he has gassed his own people. And unfortunately, as Americans, we have been lied to by our government. We have been lied to by the media as well. As it was pointed out on Veritas just recently, CNN, one of their own people there was Alfred Martyr. Alfred Martyr actually called it an invasion of Syria. And Alfred Martyr is, let me just pull up Alfred for you so you can see his face as well. This is Alfred Martyr right here. And he called it an invasion. So these things are troubling, friends, very troubling. And I hate to see this. You know, we've got some good Americans too. I'm not, like I said, I'm not the only one that's saying this. Ron Paul as well. Former U.S. Senator is also blasting our presence inside of Syria. We have no business being there. All right, now, we spoke about what Yolan said. He prefers ISIS. Let's take a look at what ISIS does. And then I want to share with you something from the biblical side of this as well. But let me just show you here. This is from Gatestone Institute International Policy Council. An article here on May 12, 2016 says, Yazdi girl exposes ISIS rape hellhole. This is just one of many, many articles you can get. Okay, so the Yazdi girls were sold in exchange for a few packs of cigarettes. They would come and take any girl against her will. If she refused, they would kill her on the spot. All quotes below from our Burhan and Shabab talk hosted by Jafar Abdul, March 22nd, 2016. All right, now I want to share with you just a few of the things that this girl writes about when she was held captured there. And this happened to her, I think she was 15 at the time. Yes, she was 15 at the time. It says, a teenage girl who went by the pseudonym of Burhan was enslaved when she was 15 and endured months of captivity before she managed to escape. She is now 17 based on 40-minute interview. Her story is as follows. All right. Now, I'm just going to highlight some of the points in here. One of the points, of course, is that they would be even sold for a pack of cigarettes. She says, before long, 17 more ISIS vehicles full of men appeared. This is when they were first being captured. The men became aggressive, ordered the Yazidis around, separated the men from the women, and marched the men away, including Burhan's fathers, brothers, uncles. The women and the children were taken to different buildings and kept under lock and key. By the way, those men were all shot, killed, and murdered as they screamed out, Allah Akbar, in the background. And then when I sit there and I listen to Israeli rabbis speak the name Allah Akbar or Allah Masha'Allah, things like this. And this is what ISIS does. I mean, this is insane, friends, insane. ISIS fighters said that they were merely moving the men to a different location, but of course they killed them all. She said, the hardest moment for me that I remember is having my hand clasped to my mother's hand and then having them forcefully broken apart. This was the hardest thing, not just for me, but for all girls and children. They killed any woman who resisted going, and they would open fire on her. Next, all boys older than six were taken to a military camp, presumably to be converted to Islam and trained as ISIS fighters. Then Burhan's group, girls and women from the ages of 9 to 22, were taken to another holding place in Mosul. I remember a man looked at least 40 years old coming and taking a 10-year-old girl. When she resisted him, he beat her severely using stones and would have opened fire on her. She had not gone with him. Everything against her will. There, Burhan founded another 5,000 Yazidi girls enslaved. They would come and take any girl against her will. If she refused, they would kill her on the spot. Really. And then we have other ones. All right, now I'm going to go into this in just a moment here. This is about Bashar al-Assad, a little documentary, but I want to pull something up for you real quick. This is from the book, I believe it's Joel chapter 3. Let me just see if I can find this real rapidly for you. I actually had this saved over here as well. Yeah, Joel 3:3 is where it's at. And it shall come to pass afterward that I will pour out my spirit upon all flesh, and your sons and your daughters shall prophesy. Your old men shall dream dreams, your young men shall see visions, and also upon the servants and upon the handmaids. In those days will I pour out my spirit, and I will show wonders. Wait a minute, this must be in a different chapter in the English is different from the Hebrew. So let me just read to you what it says here. For behold, in those days and in that time, when I shall bring again the captivity, was I even in Joel? Let me look. Yes, I was. Okay, it's probably in chapter 2. This is one more extra chapter here, or it may be chapter 4. Let me just look. Okay, in the Hebrew Bible, it's in chapter 4, but it's chapter 3, verse 1 for you guys to 3. For behold, in those days and in that time, when I shall bring back the captivity of Judah and Jerusalem, I will gather all nations and will bring them down into the valley of Jehoshaphat, and I will enter into judgment with them there for my people and for my heritage Israel, whom they have scattered among the nations and divided my land. And they have cast lots for my people and have given a boy for an harlot and sold a girl for wine and have drunk. God gathers them down there for judgment. And then former defense minister of Israel, Yolan, said he would prefer ISIS over Iran in Syria. Well, I prefer to see all these other militant groups that the U.S. has been backing, including ISIS and the Free Syrian Army and Al-Qaeda and Al-Nusra. They should all be defeated, because ISIS is being spoken of here biblically right here. It says, for they have cast lots for my people. Now, that's the Israelis, you know, but keeping in mind, it's the same thing. And have given a boy for an harlot and sold a girl for wine and have drunk. And then we find out that these ISIS members here, that this girl here says that a girl would be sold for just a couple of packs of cigarettes. It's the same nature, the same evil, the same ungodliness. And let me tell you something, God is no respecter of persons. And he feels just as much for these little girls here as he does for an Israeli girl as well. As they're being sold out for just a couple of pack of cigarettes. And you think he's not going to bring judgment upon them? Though the nations that are being gathered down there to the Valley of Jehoshaphat are also those that are aiding and abetting the ISIS members that are willing to allow this to happen. Now, let me show you, though, the difference. Seeing as Yolan prefers ISIS in Syria to rule over Syria, and that's kind of no different than what we found out from John Kerry, when John Kerry was willing on that leaked audio, said we were letting ISIS just go, hoping they would overthrow Assad. Well, let's look at the difference in the type of people that we're looking at. Let's take a look at what Assad's country, this is a documentary, it's called Syrianese, Syrian Women Under the Rule of Bashar al-Assad. Look at what he says here. I'll turn the volume down. I returned to Damascus, Syria, a country that has been, its consequences are affecting not only those, hang on. It's mainly what I want you to be able to see is some of the images here. Okay, I want to show you Syria, hang on, that we almost never talk about in the West. All right, and you can see right here, this lady here, she's not wearing a head covering. Since the beginning of the conflict, for some obscure reason, our governments have chosen to unconditionally support the rebels. Look at the freedom of the women there. The legitimate Syria, that of Bashar Assad, indisputably portrayed to us as being an absolute monster. This is Syria is voiceless.
Celle de Bachar al-Assad, présentée de par chez nous comme un monstre absolu sans aucune nuance, n'a pas voix au chapitre. Nous ne voyons pas.
We do not see nor hear of the Syrians who have remained faithful to their government, the everyday Syrian. As a result, we don't really understand the conflict.
Nous n'entendons les Syriens qui ont décidé de rester fidèles au gouvernement.
You know.
Et par conséquent.
The point is that I wanted to share with you in showing you these images here. Is that these women here, unlike that of the women under ISIS controlled, have been free to move about. They're not wearing burqas with just a little screen for flies there to look out of. They're not being forced to do that. I'm sure that there's some that do dress this way, but it's of their own choosing. You see some women with head coverings. It's their choosing. Some with not. Both Christians and Muslims walking together. Do you know, they were asked one time, and I don't know if I have the article up or not here. This was another one I brought up too from mira.co.uk. ISIS captures 7,000 women and children to sell them in social media as sex slaves. Another evil they're doing. I don't prefer them at all. Huge advances by the Syrian army has transformed the Syrian war. Let me just bring this out in closing here that I wanted to share with you as well. That the Syrian military is advancing very rapidly, and they've made it all the way to the border of Iraq. This is something that is very much frightening the U.S. coalition. The advances are happening so fast, so rapidly, that they're afraid that Bashar al-Assad will regain power. And after Saudi Arabia, Turkey too, by the way, don't forget Turkey, I don't care how much they act like they're for Russia, they're not. They have also helped in aiding and abetting all these terrorist groups inside of Syria from the very beginning. Saudi Arabia as well. They don't want to lose all the money they poured into overthrowing Bashar al-Assad. And the U.S. coalition doesn't. Neither does the European Union. They are all out to stop this. But how come they're doing such great advances? Well, it's because the Russian military has become far more involved inside of Syria. In fact, I read one article, and it's actually here as well. I'll go into that in just a moment. 1,000 servicemen of the 5th Legion completed training in Syria. These are men that have been retrained. They're already military men with the Syrian government, but Russia has been retraining their soldiers there. And these, they don't say where they've been sent to on the battlefields, but they are the ones that are making these huge advances because Russia's gotten more involved in it. In the article on the Duran that I was sharing with you a few moments ago, where they were speaking about why they wanted to take down Syria, being basically a hub for Iran to get weapons to Hezbollah, which I'm sure could have been stopped if they had made peace with Syria from the beginning. But the point is that they also noted that the reason why Syria is having more success in this war in overtaking ISIS and the other fighting factors inside of their country is because of the side of Russia being involved, not only in the aspect of training and bringing in weapons and arms, but also in the what they call the paperwork part of the war, the strategy part of the war. And I've actually seen the videos of where Russian military is directing the ground war inside of Syria, and this is why they are gaining the upper hand. That is all going to change, though, very soon. And it'll change because the U.S. coalition is bent on taking down Assad from power. I think this is also what's going to spark a war with Iran. Again, I do not say that Iran is not an enemy of Israel. I know that there have been a lot of statements by Iran that they have been for the Israeli people in times past. I agree with that. But at this point right now, you know, it's not that good of a relationship. And Israel's very concerned about Iran getting nuclear weapons, especially since they're working with North Korea. Hezbollah still is a threat for Israel. And maybe, though, these things could be worked out if we weren't going in the direction we're going in now. I'm Stephen Benoon. You're watching Israeli News Live. Shalom.